Hello, and welcome to Rock, Paper, Swords, the historical action and adventure podcast. My name is Matthew Harfy.
And my name is Stephen A. Mackay.
We are both best-selling historical fiction authors, and together we chat about all things historical and anything that could fall under the banner of action and adventure in books, film, TV and games.
Oh, and we also talk about rock music from time to time.
Names in the historical fiction space that most people instantly recognize. One of them is Bernard Cornwell, who we interviewed a few weeks ago. And of our guest today, Bernard said in his endorsement of his debut novel, Under the Eagle, "I really don't need this kind of competition." Since then, Simon Scarrow has become a household name and published more than 50 books, I think, but I'm struggling to count them all. You can tell us the exact number if you know. Simon's longest running series is Eagles of the Empire, epic Roman historical fiction featuring Macro and Cato, now up to 21 books. He's also written novels about Wellington and Napoleon, thrillers set in the Second World War, many historical action and adventures with co-author TJ Andrews, and some standalone novels set in different eras from the 16th to the 20th century. Welcome to Rock, Paper, Swords, Simon.
Hi. Hello, Simon.
Hi. It's actually 37 novels.
37 novels, and I guess I was counting all the T.J. Andrews stuff as well. That includes them as well?
That's the grand total, yeah, including the young adult fiction too. So,
all right, I don't know where I got the number from there. Maybe I just can't.
Maybe German editions or something that you've just counted up.
Yeah, no, it's called, you know, fiction writing is, you know, there's a reason why it's called fiction writing.
yeah. Well, congratulations on the 21st novel of the Eagles of the Empire series, Death to the Emperor. Could you tell us a bit about that book, which I believe is your latest book? It's just come out recently, right?
Yeah, it's out last month. And yeah, this is one I've been waiting to write for a number of years, actually, because it's set in this neck of the woods. Well, around Norfolk, East Anglia. So, it's about the Bootican Revolt and something I've been building up. And you'll know this as a series writer yourself. You kind of seed the future novels with characters and possibilities. And then when they eventually get around to writing that book, it looks like you've been awfully clever. So Boudica was there in the second book, and then she's been in a few other books. And, of course, now we're at the point of the Bootican Revolt. So it's also something, because I suppose I've been waiting so long to write it, I got a bit carried away. And it's about 15,000 words longer than normal, just because, you know, there's just so much material. And we're only up to the sacking of Colchester. The grand finale is yet to come. So that'll be the next book.
So how long is a normal Simon Scarrow novel?
It tends to be about 130,000 words to 132,000 in the first draft. And then by the time the editor's taken her scalpel to it and I've relented, it's down to about 124 or so. It used to be, you know, a much longer process, but I think after a while, you kind of second guess what the editor's going to say. And then you know, she's kind of like perched on your shoulder, you know, that kind of good little angel thing and the bad little verbose person there. And you eventually get to the stage where you can sort of second guess pretty much how she's going to react and save yourself a bit of time writing the first draft. But this time around, I made two mistakes. I got carried away. And then the second one was I for some reason, I was typing in 10 point. And of course, you know, that's less pages. I said, well, I'm not getting anywhere very fast. And then I kind of realized why.
So that shows that you must write in, it could be different programs, but I'm guessing you write in Word then, do you?
Yeah, I mean, I used to write in Word. I had a 2007 version of it, which I really, really liked. You know, it didn't have too many bells and whistles on and allowed you to get on with the job. And then it turns out that Microsoft doesn't do backwards compatibility with its Word files. So I had to get one of these, you know, that new thing, was it 365?
Yeah, Office 365, I think. Yeah.
Yeah, so now I have to, you know, it really makes, you know, really hurts. You have to pay for it every year.
Yeah, £6 a month.
Yeah, well, I stopped stopped using, I mean, I have to use Word a bit because in the editing phase, all the editors and still use it, so they want it, but I use Scrivener to write.
I was going to ask, because I've got that on the machine now, because I'm writing a musical at the moment. Ooh. And I'm trying to find some good software. And somebody, try Scrivener. You can do everything with Scrivener. So how are you getting on with it?
Well, I wrote, so my first novel, I wrote 26,000 words in Word. And then I just thought, I can't do this anymore. It's awful. I hate this bit of software. And bearing in mind, at the time I was working in IT as a technical writer, so we had to use Word sometimes, but we were using other tools, you know, to do the writing. And I just thought, there must be something better out here that will serve my needs. So I went out and did a bit of research and found Scrivener, which I much preferred, and I've never looked back. So ever since then, so that was, 8 years ago or something, and I've been using Scrivener ever since. It's just, yeah, it's brilliant. I mean, there's a lot. We could probably have a whole episode just talking about Scrivener. Maybe we should. Maybe we should have an episode talking about different, you know, get an expert in of Scrivener or something and talk about it. But without going into too much detail, you break down everything into separate little files. So each chapter is a file, each scene within the chapter is a file. So it becomes much easier to move things around, and you can put your research in as well, have it all within the same big sort of overarching file structure. So you can search for things very easily, and you can reorder things, and it's not what you see is what you get. So what you're writing is just text, and at the end you decide how to output it, and you can output to any format, including Word. And so you break it up into these structures and put chapter headings and, you know, whatever, you can decide, you know, what the metadata is, and then
it doesn't take too long to get used to it all.
Well, it didn't to me, but I mean, I'm probably only using about 10-15% of what it can do. But I think
sounds very
most of these things
to me.
You don't need to use most of it. I think people get hung up on trying to learn everything of a bit of software. It's like when you get Photoshop or something, you look at it and you think, this has got like a million things you could do, but then you only use, I don't know, 10 different commands to do most of the things that you want to do. And it's the same, I think, with these bits of software.
Yeah, I think I'm going to have to give that one a go. I mean, I've got it, as I said. It's just that I started, you know, it's one of these, I'm really, really lazy. You know, so I started working on it. I thought, I'm going to have to work hard at understanding this. So back to Word I go. I'm going to have to.
I think it's got a bit of a learning curve. I think I would imagine that if you sort of dedicate a couple of days to it, sort of looking at, you know, watching a few YouTube videos and a few tutorials, I reckon that, you know, if you can sort of get to understand the way it works, then after that it's plain sailing, really.
Okay,
and I only ever have any issues at certain stages in the phase of writing. You know, when you finish the novel and you then got to output the whole novel into Word or something, at that point, you know, you might have a few hiccups as you're sort of learning that phase. But the actual writing itself is incredibly easy. And then once you learn how to do the outputting, sort of. But it's there's a lot of information out there now. It's very popular, so you find lots of videos and things.
Yeah, I think I'll save that for my next in between books moment.
Yes, those moments when you think, now I've got loads of time, and then a week later you're writing the next book.
Well, it's the thing, you know, I thought I'd coming back here for a bit of a break and Christmas and stuff, and then you just discover you've got a sort of 5 foot high, you know, mail has built up, and then there's all the other things, you know, all the people, relatives you have to go and see, and it's Christmas.
It's Christmas, so, yeah.
Presents.
Yeah, well, yeah, I know it's you know, and it's always that thing that the problem is not buying for other people. It's when they say, "What do you want?" And you think, "Well, actually, you know, I'll tell you something, you know, not a lot," because having moved out to Mauritius and living out of a suitcase for about 3 or 4 months before the first batch of books turned up, so we've just had a laptop, about 4 or 5 books, you know, pens, paper, that sort of thing, and a change of clothes, and that's all I had for about. 4 months, didn't miss a bloody thing.
You know? Amazing, right? It's amazing. Yeah.
So now I come back here and I look around, and I'm just kind of like horrified at the level of clutter. And I've really got to, you know, do something about it because it's driving me nuts. You know, having discovered that you can get by without stuff, you just suddenly give it away willy nilly.
So, Are you basically living like Jack Reacher then? You have been living like Jack Reacher for the last sort of few months, where he just buys like one set of clothes and then wears them for a couple of days, then chucks them out and buys another set.
When they become so bloodstained, he ends
yes, well, yeah. Once you've strangled a few people and headbutted a few people to death, then you've got to throw the clothes away. I mean, it's obvious.
Yeah. Oh well, I wish, but it's just it's a real eye opener, to be honest, and I'm kind of humbled by it, because I'm just thinking this is just ridiculous. So this year I've kind of really cut down on any kind of present requests, because apart from anything, I've got to get it, you know, back to Mauritius in the suitcase, and there is an allowance. And when you start, I'll just show you. Well, no, there's the pile of things to go. Whoops, back down there.
All right.
So, that's a full suitcase in itself.
Yeah, I know. So we're allowed two suitcases. And then there's the carry-on bag, which, of course, is, you know, where all the laptops are going to go. I mean, you know, it's a great place to live, so I'm not complaining.
Well, one of the questions we had planned was to ask you about the move to Mauritius and how you're getting on there. And obviously, it sounds like you're getting on very well. How have you found the writing process there?
Well, the writing's actually a lot easier, because I'm not glued to watching the news and finding out which day of the week by which prime minister we've got, that sort of thing. So it's been a real liberation getting away from Brexit, the travails of the Conservative government, and each successive scandal that comes out and all that. And it does preoccupy you, because you're it's like the worst ever sitcom shit show, that you're ever going to see. And the joke of it, of course, is, we're the butt of the joke. And so, being as far away from that as possible, and Brexit, is very, very helpful. I've been able to write actually a lot more than was the case in the UK. So, I'm very pleased about that.
That's interesting.
Writing a musical now, so that would never have happened if I hadn't gone out there.
It's not about the Romans, is it?
Sadly not, no.
No.
But one of the reasons we moved out there is we went out 4 years ago on a holiday, and at the airport, somebody came up to my wife and said, Louise. And she turned around and said, Michelle. And I thought, what the hell? bloody Mauritian airport, who the hell is this? And it was somebody she'd sung in a band with 20 odd years ago when she was living in Geneva. And they've retired to Mauritius. So we stayed in touch, and that's how we kind of decided to go there. And it turns out this is a band with a rather serious kind of historical significance in a way. They're the first band to have a pop video on the internet, and the first band to have, it was the first image on the internet was a picture of this band.
Oh, wow.
And that's because the guy who set the band up was working at CERN. And Tim Berners-Lee was next door, busy cobbling together the internet. And he came through one day. He said, look, I just need a video and an image just to test this thing out on the, what do you got? And Silvano said, here, well, have this image, have this this video. So they went up on the internet. So they were the first things, graphics, on the internet.
Oh, wow. That's amazing.
So every 10 years, the newspapers pile in and interview this group and sort of say, it's you made history, blah, blah, blah. So anyway, I thought, oh, what a great topic for a musical, because they've got this huge catalogue of songs that they've put together, and they're really fun because they're all about physics.
Is it pop music?
It's kind of sort of 60s.
Right.
But very, very sort of catchy stuff. And the band's called Les Horribles Sonnettes, so it's LHC. It's constantly singing about, somebody's bewailing the fact that their boyfriend's always in the lab and doesn't care for them, things like this, and microwave love and things like that. So,
are you writing like a kind of Mamma Mia style musical with the music of the band?
I wish. If it's Mamma Mia, then my share of 2 billion looks good.
Yeah. That would be good.
Well, yeah. We'll keep. Is it the first musical? Yeah, is it the first musical you've written?
Yeah. Well, this is why I'm trying to find. I've got the format sorted out now and started writing the story and stuff. So we're just sort of putting it together, and I've got the back catalogue of songs. And of course, you're going through the lyrics and you're trying to work out which lyrics work best with which part of the story.
Yeah.
And then some of the lyrics are just like killingly funny as well. So, you know, I've got to find a way of kind of putting that into a performance. So, yeah, it's a lot of fun.
It sounds like a real bit of a departure from what you've done up till now. So that's never a bad thing, though.
No, I think this is, you know, this is always the thing about writing is that, and you'll know this, that you start doing a bit of research, start talking to people, and then get another idea. And then you do something else, and you get another idea. And then you get this stack of ideas that you know you're going to be only about a quarter of the way through when you peck out.
Yeah.
And that's the reality of it. You know, it's just an addiction telling stories, really.
So how did you get started then, Simon? What inspired you to write books about the Romans?
Well, about the, you know, story writing actually started when I was at school because my parents are, you know, there's cool, brutal, you know, callous middle-class types who sort of send kids away to boarding school whilst they, right. they go off and, you know, travel around the world and have fun, which, of course, didn't go down terribly well with me when I used to get these postcards from Hawaii or whatever it was when I was middle of November in the common room sort of freeze my arse off. So anyway, when the lights went out in the dormitory, we all took turns telling stories. And I got to me one night and I was getting a bit tired and I thought, and we shall continue tomorrow, leave them on a cliffhanger. And so I continued the story the next day. And then after a while, I got the job full time. And you begin to work out when the stories are working well, because everybody's silent and there's kind of stillness.
Right.
And you know when things are going slightly awry, when there's a bit of chatter and all the rest of it. And then you begin to develop the very, very basic story telling skills of, you know, building something up and then leaving them on a cliffhanger, then coming back the next day and continuing the story, and, you know, and so on. Mm-hmm. So I had that all sort of pretty much mapped out pretty quickly. And then when I went to left that school and went to another school where we had this absolutely cracking Latin teacher, and I was really crap at the subject. I mean, you know, the Latin O level, as it was in the day, was a fairly straightforward and easy thing to get through. You just had to memorize Tacitus. You know, wasn't any great shakes. So I wasn't very good at Latin. But when he stopped talking about Latin, started talking about the history, and then you're just thinking, wow, all this really cool and great stuff.
Why don't they teach you that?
Yeah, exactly. Well, they do. I mean, it's there on the kind of curriculum, but, you know, very much as a, you know, an aside, they really want you to go do all that sort of Life of Brian, you know, Roman Arnes, Ites, Domus stuff. So that's kind of where they steer you. And of course, going on holiday around Europe, you know, you just keep coming across one Roman remain after another, you know. And a combination of that, I think, got me really excited about Rome. And then, of course, you had, you know, being slightly older than you guys, we had I, Claudius on television when I was growing up. And it seemed every Sunday afternoon it was something like Cleopatra or Demetrius and the Gladiators or Spartacus or, you know, and so on, the Hall of the Roman Empire. It seemed to be on all the time for some reason. So that whole sword and sandal thing added to the history, added to the, you know, visiting all these sites. So it was always there. And I think I probably actually did most of the research whilst I was at school. So, yeah, and then when I, you know, thought about writing about Romans, that came a bit late in the day because I'd written three novels, the first three not published. They're in a dusty drawer down there somewhere. Right. And
these will come out after your death. There'll be those things, that those books that get published by people like 10 years after they've gone.
And no, you buy them. Not if I have my way.
And you buy them and you read them and you think, okay, so the estate needed some money, I get it, but I understand why they weren't published.
Yeah. Well, I think I'll leave them, you know, strict instructions that they're to be left lining hamster cages or something. You know, that's all they're good for, really. But, and it was really because I was, you know, that classic sort of beginner writer mistake of going to the bookshops, looking at what's selling and thinking, yeah, well, I'll do that, you know.
Right.
And your heart's not really in it, but, you know, you just want to mimic that success. And, you know, at the same time, I was thinking, you know, what do I want to read? And I've just been introduced to Falco, Lindsay Davis's detective series, which is kind of Raymond Chandler in ancient Rome, and she does it really well. But at the same time, I was thinking, you know, I really want something more military than detective. What is there? And of course, there wasn't anything at the time. It was all sort of emperors and generals and things like that. So I thought, well, okay, well, I'll write this one for me. And I think that's the point at which you'd be realized that, you know, you have to believe in the product. You know, you have to believe in what you're writing.
You know, absolutely.
I think, was it Robert Frost made that comment about, you know, no tears in the writer, no tears in the reader.
Yeah.
There's no surprise for the writer, no surprise for the reader. And he's damn right. You know,
it's definitely true that, you know, it's very good advice to write a book that you want to read, because you could be sure, pretty much sure, that you're not going to be the only person on the whole planet that wants to read that same sort of type of story.
Yeah. But I think that's a pretty common mistake amongst people, you know, starting out, is that they think, okay, well, what can I do that's going to sell a lot, you know, rather than
just to make money.
Yeah. Which let's not decry that.
Oh no, at all.
But if that's just actually, you know, one of the reasons I'm out in Mauritius is to set up a creative writing course at the local university there. And my whole take on it is it's creative writing as a commercial activity. Because one of the things I've noticed when I've been along to a lot of the creative writing workshops and courses here is that, you know, you ask people and that their ambition is to make a living out of it, you know, and they're quite open about that. Yeah. You think, well, why isn't that the starting point? You know, why is it all this kind of fine writing, blah, 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 blah. And then, oh, yes, and you may want to get an agent and publisher and this sort of thing. You know, you should actually start from, okay, I want to make a living out of this. You know, okay, if this is the thing I want to write, then how am I going to monetize it? What sort of possibilities are there for, you know, creating an income out of this? And so, you know, you can't set up that kind of course here in the UK because, you know, the creative writing mafia, for want of a better word, have, you know, pretty much nailed down the format of the course. And anybody that sort of says, well, I'm here to make some money, or, you know, I want to make a living out of it, you know, is going to get looked at down on a very long nose, I think. So the beauty of doing it in Mauritius is there's no creative writing courses there at all. So, you know, there's a blank slate, and I can kind of set one up that, you know, thinks about it more as a commercial proposition along with the writing. So,
but it's really interesting. There's a real split of writers and people in the writing establishment, or the, you know, publishing industry, or whatever you want to call it, in the UK of people. Obviously, the publishing industry is there to make money, but writers, there's a real split of the writers who just think I'm creating art, and it's, you know, if I make money, well, you know, that's well and good, but I want to write the, you know, the next amazing novel, and if I make money out of it, that's brilliant. But then there's the other side of people that, you know, probably the mid-list writers who are just writing and they want to make a living out of it. And they do, hopefully, you know, some of them, like us, succeed in making a living out of it.
But I think half of them probably just don't want to admit it. They'll say that they want to create art, whereas they really do want to make money, but they think they can't admit it.
Yeah. Well, it seems some, you know, I mean, this is one of the problems with that kind of course and that kind of attitude is that, you know, they make it sound like a bad thing. Actually, you know, most people sign up for these courses, that's exactly what they want to do. The danger is that, you know, if you just discourage the, you know, if you just encourage the way of doing things at the moment that there is, you end up lots and lots of these people who write books which consist of, you know, big words, small print, low sales. And then they eventually go on to become lecturers of creative writing. And then you just perpetuate this problem. And I think, I get really pissed off, actually, you know, when people go, oh, yeah, you're, what's that lovely phrase that Ben Kane made into a T-shirt?
Jack, oh, I know what you mean.
Another fucking Roman author.
Was that Angus Donald that came up with that, or?
He was a bit, apparently, so the story goes, I wasn't there that night, but Angus got a bit drunk and, you know, and he was amongst Roman authors, and somebody had made some comments and he sort of said, what do you know? You're just another fucking Roman author. So Jaffra was born. But, you know, this is the thing, that there is a sort of a, you know, you're just another commercial fiction writer.
Yes, snobbery.
There's the snobbery of genre fiction, as if genre fiction was somehow easy. It's like when people talk about, you know, commercial movies not, you know, not being good or whatever. You think, well, they're the ones that are making the, you know, like Avatar 2, whatever, coming out now, it's cost, I don't know how many millions, but it's going to make, you know, hundreds and hundreds of millions of dollars.
Because people enjoy it.
That's what people want to see.
Well, this is it. You know, what is wrong with enjoying a story? And I remember some years ago, there was a big debate on, I think, one of the literary review magazines or something about, you know, should a writer concentrate on style or story? That was the kind of the big issue. And it was really, really interesting how, and they broke it down so that the vast majority of people who thought that style was important lived in London, you know, which I thought was really quite revealing. And those who are sort of more concerned with story were the sort of provincial types. And you're kind of thinking, well, you know, style's fine, and style is something we can aspire to. And every so often we'll write a paragraph or a, you know, a sentence where we feel very, very pleased. Yeah. And you read it back and you think, yeah, that's good. You know, but at the same time, if that's all it ever was, and sometimes, you know, I've read quite a few of these because I was unfortunately in a men's reading group where a couple of the guys there were very much of that school. Well, if it's by a product of the creative writing, you know, UEA, it must be good, and therefore we will read it. And you know, you end up reading. You know, I'm not a fan of Ian McEwan. I'm really not. And you know, when you actually have to go through several of his books, and you begin to think. You know, so you've spent the last 20 pages talking about cooking ravioli, or 15 pages covering the squash game, or, you know, and then you have the most sort of preposterously unbelievable plot. And you're thinking, okay, there is a nicely written sentence here once in a while, but, you know, this is just...
Yeah, there's no story.
Yeah.
And, no book.
You know, what we're trying to do is, you know, I think one of the beauties of writing is that we are only half of the equation. You know, you can be a good or an indifferent writer. You can be a good or indifferent reader as well. And what I think the game is for me is to try and make it easy for good readers, so that in the sense that, you know, we put the black marks down on white paper. That's all we do. What they do is then take those black marks and turn them into magic in their heads, you know. And the beauty of reading is that every single novel is going to be read differently by every single reader, you know, yeah. And you're going to have this wonderful kind of, double effort between the two of us to create this kind of magic. And I think, you know, that tends to get lost in the mix, so that there are good and bad readers as well as good and bad writers.
Yeah.
And of course, you know, when you go and see a movie, you know, no matter how good Avatar is, it's going to be the same movie for everybody who watches it. Whereas if Avatar was a book, you know, it's a unique experience for everybody.
Well, that's why it costs hundreds of millions to make Avatar, because you have to do all of that to make it unequivocal so people can see exactly what you want them to see. And so the director can put on the screen and say, well, Cameron can say, this is exactly what I want people to see. Whereas we can't do that. We can impart the knowledge that we want.
That's what I think I prefer about writing, actually, and I prefer about reading. Is that, it's so personal. It is so kind of creative in a way that going to the cinema isn't. You know, cinema, it's pretty passive.
Yeah.
You know, and you either like the story or you don't. You either analyze it or you don't. You know, you've got very limited kind of options. As a reader, though, once you've paid the entrance ticket price, you know, you're the one that's kind of creating this.
Yeah, exactly.
There's
a creative aspect even when you're the reader.
Absolutely. And the reader can choose to skip bits. You know, lots of people say, well, I'm bored with that description, so I'll skip and go to the dialogue or whatever. You can choose to do that.
And you can pause, you know, without having to hit the pause button, mm-hmm. you know, just to reread a sort of sentence or mm-hmm. you know, to read it differently, or to stop and think about something, or to scribble in the margin. When can you scribble in the margin when you're watching a movie?
Yeah.
You know. And how often do we do that? I mean, you know, I'm sure you do. I mean, you know, I do. I mean, I'm sitting there with my kind of, not, you know, highlighter or anything like that, but I've got a very, very fine point nib so I can get plenty of notes in the margin. And if it's a sort of non-fiction thing, fine. Sometimes with fiction, though, I'll do it because, you know, if I'm reading something that really bowls me over or I abhor, you know, I will sort of, I want to know why. I want to know why it's having that effect on me. So I'll sort of think it through and make the comments in the margin. You know, which of course also mitigates against buying ebooks, of course, but there we go.
Well, you mentioned about the Jaffra thing, so I was just curious, how do you feel about the amount of like Roman novels that are out now and the authors? Because when you got some success, loads of people started doing it. I don't know if they copied you or not, but they certainly followed the same formula.
Yeah, I don't think, I'm not sure about copying. I think that the thing is, it's not so much that it's copying. I think it's the publishers. Once they actually see that there's a big market, you know, and they sort of think, well, they're, you know, over at Headline, they're doing well with this new sort of Scarrow guy. So what do we need something like that? And then the whole thing kind of rolls out along those something. And I'm pretty sure that there are, it's like anything that in a kind of creative or business world, you know, you're not necessarily the only one doing something, but the trick is being the first.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
And I think that I was lucky. And also, you know, there are things that are outside of your control as well. It was, let me see, it's a month after my first book came out, Gladiator appeared in cinemas. You know, you really could plan that kind of thing. You know?
Perfect promotion.
So, you know, people sort of make it, you know, there's a tendency for some people to think, oh, well, you know, you've done 37 odd books. You know, that it was a foregone conclusion and they kind of read things retrospectively. You think, no, it's a lottery. What if Gladiator hadn't been released?
Yeah.
What if the manuscript had gone to the, you know, an editor whose list was full? What if, you know, the agent I'd sent it to on the day who accepted it had got a bad hangover or had read one too many bad Roman books? You know, that's the reality.
Or if Gladiator had been bad. And so instead of being like really good publicity, everyone had gone, ugh, Romans, you know, the rubbish. That movie was terrible and it all, you know, dropped like a stone. But
yeah, well, I don't think that Britannia television series has done anybody in Rome thinks any favours. You know?
No. So, there was a Beowulf series a while back and I managed to watch 20 minutes of one episode before I gave up on it. So, yeah.
Well, you know, it's hard, isn't it? Because, you know, when somebody comes out with something that you think, you really want to be a success.
You want to enjoy it, yeah.
And you just think, oh, no.
I know. It's terrible because the build-up of seeing that, oh, this program's coming out, oh, that could be great. And then you sit down that first night and think, oh, no, what have they done? This is just terrible.
I had that with, there was some crime series on the telly called Inside Man, David Tennant and Tushy.
Okay, yeah.
And, and you think Stephen Moffat, okay, well, it should be okay. But, it, you know, you just... waiting for it, you know, you painfully, because they're two really good actors, quite meaty roles, but this story is so bad and you just
didn't work.
Well, it was kind of cringingly bad, you know. People you know, it was one of these things where the guy had actually worked out the story and then gone back and made sure all the characters did everything they could to make the plot work rather than sort of acting in, you know, true to their character or anything like this. So it was just, you know, Deus Ex Machina on every page. Mm-hmm. You know. And that really kind of hurts when you're reading it or seeing it on the screen.
Yeah. So I know lots of our listeners are going to be thinking, ask him more about Macro and Cato and his historical fiction novels, because we're kind of talking about writing in general and things, which is all really interesting. But I'm just going to take it back to a couple of things we've already talked about. So we talked about, you've got 21 novels in the big series, the... Eagles of the Empire series. So how many of them, because you talked about, you had some of the characters and some of the events are sort of seeded early on and then you brought them back and you sort of bring things to fruition. You've already mentioned there's going to be another one featuring Boudicca, I think, again. But how many have you got planned in total, and have you got a total plan?
I never had a total planned. You know, when we got the original publishing deal, my agent said, oh, you know, how many do you think you're going to write? And I thought, well, you know, 9, 10, if I'm lucky. And she said, well, don't count on more than 6, you know, because this is how these things tend to work out in the end. And the publisher commissioned 3 in the first instance. And I said, well, we'll see how it goes, if there's going to be a second deal. So, you know, you have no idea how well it's going to go. And I hadn't planned it out. And I don't plan things out now. I can sort of see that there is a story arc that may... You know, need be one novel, it might be 2 or 3 novels, possibly. But, you know, that's as far as it goes. There's no sort of big plan, you know, for the entire series. And then there's no big plan either within each novel. I mean, when I start it, I know who the villain's going to be. I know where it's going to be set. I know what the main problem that they've got to resolve is for the book. And that's a half side of A4. And then we write, you know.
Yep.
So, and it's... Because I want that, you know, frosting again. I want to, you know, live the story as I'm writing it. I don't want to know what's coming next, you know. I want the guys to actually work it out for me. And the beauty of it is, of course, you know, that they will do stuff. They will say things.
Unexpected.
Yeah, exactly. Yep. When that happens, you just think, well, you know, I'm shocked. And you think, that's good. That's really good.
Yeah.
You know, if I'm going to be surprised, then hopefully the reader will. You know,
I've had moments when people have contacted me and said, you killed so and so, you know, character in the story, and I said, no, I didn't. I said, hang on a minute, I just wrote it down.
Yeah, yeah.
Somebody, no, I didn't kill him. Some guy.
Like what
him.
You know, hey.
Yeah. But yes, because sometimes it just happens. And you're just, you know, you maybe don't expect a certain character to get killed or to kill another character, and then suddenly you're in a moment and think, oh,
or
actually.
As I said about seeding stuff, I remember early in one of the early books, Macro, you know, going on about the, you know, some bloody Marine his mother had run off with, you know, when he was young.
Yeah, I remember that.
Yeah, and there's about four or five books later, and Macro and Cato have got to go and do some sort of thing with the Roman Navy in the Adriatic.
I guess who he meets.
Yeah, well, exactly. So I hadn't thought about it. Even as he was with this column of recruits marching to Ravenna under this old veteran, and they, you know, and I didn't think about it, you know, and they were just getting on really, really well. And the guy said, "Well, look, you know, I'm on the verge of retiring. When we get to Ravenna, come down to the bar I own and meet my squeeze." And I thought, "Oh, you know, okay." So then, anyway, they're in the bar, and then and she goes, "Ah, here she is now." And as I was typing it, so Macro looked up and said, "Hello, Mum." What?
This is funny. This is stuck in my head. I remember this very distinctly, even though I must have read it years ago.
Yeah,
it's obviously a good scene.
Well, it was, you know, there's a big punch up. You know, realize it puts two and two together.
but as you said, though, you know, it's a shock for you when you were writing it, and it obviously shocked Stephen when he read it as well. So I mean, that's the magic, isn't it?
That's the magic, you
know. Yeah, and you know, that's where I think, you know, you can't afford to. I mean, you know, it depends on what you're writing. If you know, you're doing Wellington and Napoleon, you've got a very limited scope for doing that.
Yeah.
Although, you know, you find out some nice little nuggets where, you know, for example, Napoleon was had a rabbit shoot organised for the Imperial Court, and unfortunately, one of his soldier he put in charge of organising this didn't realise there's a difference between wild rabbits and tame rabbits, and so he'd bought a whole load of tame rabbits, and they let the cages open, expecting them all to bolt so they could be shot, and they kind of ambled out. Yeah,
well, nibbled the grass,
and sort of came up and sort of nibbled people's fingers looked at them endearingly. And this
you couldn't shoot them, could you?
Well, it caused a bit of a, you know, I have it with Napoleon, obviously absolutely outraged, and he sort of scrambles back into his coach in a foul temper, and then freezes because sitting opposite him is a rabbit eyeing him curiously. So, I mean, sometimes, you know, you can come across something that's factual and you can spin it slightly to surprise the reader. But if you're doing something like Macro and Cato, where, you know, the big history is in the background, and, you know, with Macro and Cato, you know, you can sort of, they can do that. They can surprise you. They can do their own thing. And it's great being an amanuensis, really, when they're at work.
Well, I wanted to ask how you keep track of all these books, the Macro and Cato ones, because I remember picking one up more than once and starting to read it. And then I get quite a few chapters in and I realise that I've already read it because, you know, the covers are quite similar and the titles are quite similar. So how do you keep track of it?
I'd love to say I've got a very sort of thorough card index and all this.
Stuff.
And the answer is, I don't. And you try and keep as much in your head as possible, but and I really should actually have some sort of database for all this.
Yeah, document or something.
Because it can go horribly wrong. We'd got to almost galley proofs, I think, with one of the books where I was driving my oldest son to Scouts, and he said, "So what's the latest one about then?" So I said, "Oh, it's about this guy who's the son of Telemachus, who's the son of this guy in an earlier book." My son looked at me and he said, "No, he's not. That's not his name. His name's Ajax." You know, and I said, "You sure?" And he went, "Absolutely, Dad. You know, I've read all the books. I know." And having a younger, slightly more accurate mind, he was right. So we were able to catch that one. You know, but it was really funny. You know, you do this thing, and I'm sure it's as much a function of age as stupidity. But you have this where you remember something very, very clearly, and it's 100% wrong.
Yeah,
false memory.
I noticed that I've got like lists of Anglo-Saxon names and lists of Visigothic names and Frankish names, whatever, and I'll use one in a book, and then the next book, a name will crop up in my. I'll end up using it again, and I'll only find it when I get to like the editing stage. Hang on a minute, this was it's the same name that I gave, a side character in the. I mean, obviously, certain names just sound good to me, and I think, well,
there's only so many of them.
A great name, but there's like a list, and some of them I think, oh, that sounds rubbish. That sounds rubbish. And this one's good, and I end up using the same bloody name again.
Yeah, you have to be careful of that. You know, there's only so many times you can put Biggest Diggus in a Roman.
Silius Sodus.
Yeah.
So you mentioned
buttocks.
Yes. Do you find this weasible? So you said you're writing this musical at the moment. Have you got, apart from the music, are you writing a novel as well, or are you one of these people that writes just one thing and then finishes that and moves on to the next? Or
No. The thing is, I'm a guy. You know how it is. We do one thing at a time and not necessarily well. I really wish I could multitask. So it's going to be, I'm doing this, roughing out this sort of musical stuff now. Then in January, I've got to start the next Macro and Cato book.
Okay.
Then I've got to do, I'm still, I can work on two things at once if I'm co-writing. So I'll be working on that. And at the same time, I'm working with TJ on a Caratacus trilogy. So, we're doing, the Roman invasion from the other side, which is a lot of fun, actually. I'm particularly enjoying this one because we've got it down as a Roman historian who's sick of writing these kind of hagiographies of aristocrats. And he comes across Caratacus in exile in Rome and says, well, here's a really good story, really interesting guy. And then, he becomes aware of the fact that Caratacus is telling him the story that Caratacus wants to tell, and that he needs to sort of catch, make sure that this is true. And at the same time, he's being pressured by the high ups in Rome, sort of saying, you sure you really want to be writing this story? Not really good for your career or your life. So he's having to. So it's very much how does history get written, particularly in difficult political situations. So, as well as telling Caratacus' story. So we're having a lot of fun with that. So that's being co-written at the same time as I'll be doing the next Macro and Cato. And then I should catch a break in April, I think, where I'll do some more of the musical before I start the next German detective novel to finish towards the end of the year. So, it tends to be about three or four projects.
Well, there's lots going on.
Yeah, yeah. Tell me about it.
So how did your collaboration come about with TJ Andrews, and how does it work?
Well, I'd co-written a film script with my brother some years before, and the way it worked seemed to go pretty well. So I wrote the first in screenplay, 20 minutes or so. Then I'd hand it over to him, and he'd edit what I'd done, and then he'd add to the next 20 minutes, and then we'd flip it back and do that. And occasionally we'd sort of meet up and discuss how things were going and ideas we had. And because we were on the same wavelength, it worked out quite well. So I thought, well, okay, when Headlines suggested what about doing a sort of an ebook series with TJ? And I said, okay. We started writing this, and originally Headline wanted it to go out under my name, no mention of him at all. And I thought, well, we're not having that really, because, and I didn't realize that they were, because my agent didn't tell me that the cut was sort of 65% me, 35% him, which she said, well, that's really, really good for ghostwriters. A lot of them get less than that. And I thought, well, this is no way to proceed, So we had a little rejig, so it's 50-50, because I think that's probably fair, and it stops any arguments or any resentment.
Yeah.
And also TJ's name goes on the cover. And, and I think
that's a big difference, because I wondered about that, because I was looking, and obviously, we said that TJ has done ghostwriting for other people. But normally and very often ghostwriters don't get a mention at all, on covers.
Well, I think that's pretty scandalous.
Yeah, that seems unfair. Yeah.
Because
I know people that have ghostwritten stuff, and they get a fee and that's it. And it's terrible because it doesn't help you for your curriculum. For your resume, you can't say really openly, I wrote.
No, but I mean, in good conscience, how can you work under those sort of,
take the credit for somebody else's writing?
Absolutely. I mean, that's a very conservative thing to do. And of course, we don't like that. So, so that's kind of how that happened. And then, with TJ, because we get on really well, that's always a good plus. He's a very creative thinker. He's been doing a lot of writing, under his own name and under, other people's names for a long time. And he's an ex-editor as well. So he knows the score.
Yeah.
And it's really nice when we have one of our creative meetings where we just sit there and you say, well, we've done this and this is where the character's going. And then somebody will say, well, what about if we do it this way? And you think, yeah, shit, why didn't I think of that? That's really good. That's really good. Let's go that. And so the whole thing works really organically and builds itself up. And I think it can be a really, really productive experience. And, we've done 3 books now and we've got the 4th one we've finished and we're going, there's another 2 that we're going to write for sure. And then I have an idea for sort of a young macro series we could co-write as well.
Okay.
That would be good. So
how does the actual writing part of it work? So you do the brainstorming, the creative part of the story?
I do the first 20,000 words to get the thing kicked off. Because in this case, with the Caratacus, I wanted a very, very distinct voice for this Roman historian. So I was thinking kind of mentally sort of David Starkey with a toga, so you have to give it that kind of voice, that way of looking at things. And it's from his first person, from his point of view. And then when we meet Caratacus and we get in to go back to history, same thing, you need to have a sense of how that will look. So once you sort of set a baseline style, a house style for the book, and then we can sort of start talking about the plot. And then, TJ kicks in and we sort of redo the first bit. He adds a bit on, and we go from there, backwards and forwards.
That's really interesting, because I wondered if, you came up with the storyline and just said, here you go, I've written a 2 sides of A4, now write a novel. But it's not like that. It's much more collaborative.
Well, it's far too much fun to want to let everybody else have all the fun.
Yeah.
So that's why. And also, I think, well, if we're splitting it 50-50, then I've got, dibs on 50% of the content, for me to write and, mess around with. So, it has to be that way, because I once got involved with a couple of other writers, and we were going to set up this thing called Story Architects, where we pooled our ideas and research and then the whole thing fell apart because everybody said, well, if it's my idea, then I should get 80% of it and you should get 20%. You think, well, we're now going to spend all our time talking about percentages.
That's like being in a band when the band's like, well, I wrote this bit of that song, so I need to have this credit and I want that percentage. And it's tough.
So you have to, just solve all your problems at the start and say 50%, 50-50. Yeah. And, you get your name on the book. Then there's no arguments. Tim's happy. I'm happy. The whole thing's fairly seamless. And I would, if you haven't done it yet, it's certainly something I would give a go, because, it's so different from writing.
Yeah, something I've every now and again thought about. People have said, because we're doing the podcast again, said, oh, have you and Stephen thought about doing a book together? And I think, well, no, I haven't. We hadn't, but we both thought, no, but who knows, maybe one day. I'll give you 2 sides of A4 and... I need to write it and we'll split it 50-50. Sounds good to me.
I'll do that, but I want 65.
You see, this is how...
Oh, no. What's going to happen? You mentioned... So moving on quickly before we fall out. You mentioned earlier about writing a screenplay with your brother, Alex Scarrow. Yeah. And I've actually got a question already about that, but that flows nicely into this. So... very recently I mentioned Jack Reacher, and Lee Child's done this thing where he's kind of retiring handing over to his brother, who's also
a
writer.
He has to rename himself
to carry on the family business. And is that something that you would consider doing with your brother? Is it something that you can you imagine that happening, that you could sort of say, well, I don't want to write any more Macro and Cato, but how about you take on the
Well, he did, there was when we were still talking, and that's another issue. He was writing something called the Time Riders series, for a young adult series for Penguin, about this sort of agency that's set up to, because time travel is being created, so this agency being set up to stop people manipulating time. So he said, well, can I use Macro and Cato in I'm writing one about Rome. And I said, well, yeah, you can, but you've got a real challenge there, because it's for kids and Macro is not kid language friendly. So so he did. There's this thing called Gates of Rome, and I think it's the 5th book in the series, and I was really impressed, to be honest. He had it was Caligula's wasn't assassinated because Caligula has discovered this time traveler in ancient Rome and uses technology to stay in power. So Cato is now head of the Praetorian Guard and constantly sort of tidying up behind Caligula. Macro's retired and gone into real estate. And, you know, it was just really interesting, you know, because he sounded like Macro without swearing, and I didn't know that was possible. So, you know, all credit to him for that. But, yeah, I think, you know, but the trouble is, you know, because of the family situation, I'm afraid that any further kind of collaboration with him is completely out of the question until he shows a little bit of contrition.
Okay.
Family, eh?
Family, yes.
It's like bloody EastEnders, isn't it?
Yeah. I'll move on from this.
Let's cast it. We'll draw a veil over that and move on.
Do you have
on.
any particularly interesting research stories, Simon?
Well, not. I mean, only insofar as I'd like to go to where, you know, the books are set. And when I was writing the Eagle in the Sand, I think that's the one. So that, I think it was the fifth book in the series. I think it might've been the fifth or sixth, I can't remember. But anyway, I was still teaching at the time. And I thought, well, how am I gonna get to this fort? Because I'd seen it on the website, I'd done the research on the internet. And there's this fort called Kayser Bashir in the Jordanian desert. And you know, I thought, well, I really wanna go and see that because it's the best preserved Roman fort anywhere in the world. And I thought, well, how the hell am I going to get there? So I was thinking this through. And then one day as I was teaching, my phone went off. And of course, it's that kind of, oh, no. You know, because you bollock the students, you know, if their phone goes off. And this happens to you. Total schadenfreude moment. So anyway, I answered the phone. And this guy said, is that Simon Scarrow? And I said, yeah. And he said, my name is Timur Dagestani. I'm the Jordanian ambassador. And big fan of your books, and so is a friend of mine, the King of Jordan, and he, you know, His Majesty wonders if you'd like to come out to Jordan and see the ancient ruins there. And I'm thinking, you know, this student's really good. I'm really impressed. Really? That's nice. Yeah. So His Majesty would like me to. yes, Mrs. Scarrow. You know, and he could see he was feeling a bit. Why is he being a bit funny? You know, and I'm thinking this student is bloody good. You know, whoever they've got doing this is really terrific. And then of course the penny dropped and it was real. To cut the story short, we went out to Jordan and we were sort of shown around for a couple of weeks. And he said, is there anything particularly you want to see? And I said, yeah, I want to see this fort in the desert. And he said, well, I've never heard of it. And so he got his Minister of Tourism in. And he said, have you heard of this place? And he said, no, I've never heard of this. He said, well, there is a guy who might, Samer Musha, who's a sort of film scout working for the Jordanian Film Commission that they just set up. So they got this guy, Samer, and he said, yeah, I know. I scouted it a few years ago. It's in the middle of the desert, nearest town's Al-Katrana. I can guide you there by phone if you like. So the king said, yeah, okay, no problem. We'll sort that out for you. So anyway, next day or so, he lent me one of his Land Cruisers and one of his bodyguards, a guy called Mered, who was so cool, I included him in the book because he had a trunk full of guns and stuff. And he had this kind of weird laser eyes. So if anybody cut us up on the road, he'd sort of plop alongside them, glare at them, and then sort of swerve off and crash into the desert. I mean, he was cool. And my son loved him. You know, he thought he was absolutely rocked. So we drive out into the desert. And so Murad's on the phone in one hand, driving in the other and getting in the directions of Samer Musha. So we find this Roman fort. And it was fantastic. The only damage that had been done to it was by an earthquake a couple of hundred years earlier, which had flattened some of the interior buildings. But the walls were there, the towers were there.
Wow.
Climb up to the towers, look over the desert, all there. And, you know, I thought, nobody's been here. You know, there's no sign of rubbish or anything like that. And because it's sufficiently far away from the nearest settlement, nobody's used the stones to recycle for buildings. So it's all still there. So, you know, it's an absolutely fabulous experience visiting this place. And then when I was, you know, the trouble is I was talking about it in interviews and stuff afterwards. And then a couple of years later, I got an email from a French guy saying, yeah, he said, I really like the books and stuff. And I, you know, this thought sounded great. So I thought I'd have a rave there. So he'd basically used this fort as a site for a rave.
Oh, God.
And they trashed the place.
Oh, no.
So, I mean, well, they didn't. There's a limit to, you know, how much trash the Roman fort can do. But you can leave a lot of rubbish around, that's for sure. So I thought, you know, you have to be a little bit careful in future. If you come across something, you know, you don't tell everybody.
Yeah, keep it a secret.
Yeah, gosh, that's still nice to have. Nice to have readers, not maybe
well,
not so much
yeah.
like the
you know the next the sort of follow up to this, don't you?
What
did you go to one?
No. I was talking to Timor in Cambridge the other day, and he was talking about your book.
And, mine.
Yeah.
I'm pretending that I didn't know this, but yeah, you actually. Yeah.
So, you know, he said, yeah, he really likes it because, you know, he said the King's a real big, you know, he really likes the way that you've kind of created this thing where people go into battle and they're not all kind of heroic and all the rest of it. They're just kind of pissing themselves and you know, hoping that nothing happens to them, you know, whilst they're fighting. And he said, you know, that because that's how it is, you know. So, you know. If you get that call,
I was going to say, if I get that call, I'm going to have to think quickly about writing a book set in Jordan. So we'll make sure he hears about this. So I'm sure I can think of something to write in Jordan. I mean, you know,
you will now. Yeah.
I will now. Yeah. If I get the call, I won't think it's a sort of a student taking the piss. At least I don't have any students to.
Yeah. Yeah.
So
that's the research story. Sorry.
That's the research story. It's a good one.
Good,
it's a good
one. Yep.
And the rest of it's pretty boring, actually. It's just lots of talking to reenactors. And well, there's one guy, actually. I tell you, reenactors are really useful. There's also this strand of historian researcher who actually recreates the stuff to test it and doesn't, trust the original sources. A guy called Peter Connolly. I don't know if you come across his book.
Peter Connolly, Greece, no.
Greece and Rome at War. It's a lovely, beautifully illustrated book because he started out as an illustrator. But... you know, he completely killed something I've been told about Roman javelins at school and many times, you know, in the text that these javelins were designed. They were so clever because they would throw them and the sort of tang would bend so they couldn't throw it back. You know, and he said, that's absolute rubbish. I spent 2 years building javelins and throwing them sheets of plywood and I couldn't get it, you know, never. Could I get that to happen? So the long tang there is, you know, it's there to basically penetrate the shield far enough to skewer the guy behind it. That's all it's there for.
Yeah.
All the stuff about it bending and not being...
Funnily enough, the Romans designed a weapon that was just designed to kill people.
Yeah, well, who knew?
Who knew? So we designed this sword so we can stick it in your guts. We designed this spear so it would just skewer you. Yeah.
We designed this sword so craply that nobody would ever want to use it against you. You know, I mean, for God's sake. You know, so he'd sort of taken that as his first principle of, well, why would you design a defective weapon?
Yeah, it doesn't make a lot of sense because you have got those sort of weapons that have got barbs that are designed that you can't pull them out. You know, that's obviously...
They have to go. Well, there's a lovely book on Roman medicine that a friend gave me, and it was talking about arrow extraction.
It's with the feathers.
Well, you push it through.
Yeah, yeah.
In the same direction, you can't take it back. Exactly. So you have to create an incision, reach through, pull it through from the other side. And it was describing it in some detail. I thought, I think I put that in one of the books, actually, where Macro gets pegged by an arrow.
Well, I've just put one... similar to that in a book, but they actually used feathers. So if you picture the arrowhead, kind of V-shape and the pointy part, they put feathers on the sharp part and pull it out using the feathers almost. So it doesn't rip your skin out. It's hard to describe, but there's actually a video on YouTube, a guy that shoves it into a big block of meat and then he gets the feathers and pushes them in and then you can pull the whole arrow out. I would imagine it's still absolute agony.
But I wouldn't want to do it.
Yeah, yeah, but it doesn't rip all your flesh apart on the way out.
No. So well, I had a again, you know, you can use these experiences if you're lucky, unlucky enough to have them. I had a really bad accident when I was skiing when I was a kid, and I had sort of tumbled over and got a ski caught between my legs, and it ripped open my thigh. And it was really interesting because I was the last person coming down the mountain, and the lifts had closed. So I had to sort of walk back up to the top of the cable car, wake the guy up to take me down. It was a small ski resort, and there was no doctor there. And so somebody had to call in a medic from a local alpine regiment who was exercising the area. And he didn't have any kind of, anything knock me out or anything like that. So he had to basically, he went out, made some snowballs to pack around the wound to cool it down and numb it. And then he stitched up the muscle inside. So the muscle had severed. So he'd had to put it back and overlap it and then stitch it up and then pull the skin over and do this. And the whole thing took about an hour. Oof. And it was really, really interesting, you know, from the point of view of initially when the shock kicked in. And I was looking down at my leg and I could see this flap muscle and this, you know, ripped open thigh. And I was thinking, but it doesn't hurt.
Right.
You know, yeah. This is really, really strange. And it only really started hurting when he started, you know, sewing it all back up. And then you begin to realize just how painful something like that can be. And that you have to keep still. And, you know, all the strategies, mental strategies you kind of develop for as you're doing it, you know, think about something else or focus on holding something really, really tightly, you know, just to get you through it.
It's funny how adrenaline works. I broke my leg when I was younger and I actually snapped in half.
Nice.
I got hit by a car. But like you, there was no pain. I can distinctly remember pushing myself off the road with a leg flopping up and down. But there was no pain whatsoever. And I just pulled myself off and lay in the road until the ambulance came. And then it started to get sore later on. But it's funny, the adrenaline,
it's a strange thing. It really is. You know, who would have thought that something like that would, you know.
Not hurt, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
No, not hurt in the instant, yeah, but later on.
Eventually, it did eventually.
Yeah.
But I guess slightly, you know, it's a difficult problem insofar as this thing cutting my thing is about an inch below my balls. Okay.
Right.
So every evening, there was a nurse who was going out, one of the PE teachers had taken on sick, so she would have to change the dressing. And everybody would crowd round, taking bets on whether I'd get an erection or not while she was changing the. Oh, God, yeah, that was humiliating. And that required huge self-control.
Okay, right. Yeah.
You have to think of broccoli or something instead.
I like the way you used the word huge then with such emphasis.
Well, actually, I had a hot tip for that. Somebody said, think about Mrs. Thatcher in a cat suit. Worked every time. You know.
Yeah. Right, moving on.
Yeah, please.
Well, we've been talking for about an hour, which is normally sort of what we aim to do. But I think you've got one more question. Yeah,
how much of this are you going to have to edit out,
Stephen? Well, probably half of it. I don't know, Stephen. You got a question there.
Is this a Christmas one?
Yeah. Do you want to ask?
Yes. Well, it's Christmas time, and when I used to work as a meter reader, I always took the Christmas period off as holidays. But one year, my manager refused, and I was so angry that I actually spent the entire time sitting in my car, and I managed to read two of your novels rather than going out to work. So that taught them a lesson, hopefully. I certainly enjoyed it anyway. So I have very fond memories of that year, but is your Christmas any different now in Mauritius? But, well, we know it's not, Matthew, so I don't know why you told me to ask that.
Ah, because
he's not there.
Well, he's not there, but you could have reworded the question slightly.
Well, I never realised until I got to the end what I'd said. Well, I suppose New Year will be different, won't it?
Well, this is it. So I thought you were going to lead in with the, so what are you going to do, you know, when you go back to Mauritius now that it's Christmas and, yeah.
No, well, I don't know what the deal is in Mauritius, actually. I mean, they have so many religious festivals there. Because this is one of the things I really like about it. People are amazing. So there's 50% Hindu, there's 30% Muslim and 20% Christian. And, you know, they've kind of cottoned on to the fact that rather than have any kind of religious strife, we get to enjoy each other's holidays.
Right? All the holidays, yeah.
So they have loads and loads of public holidays, you know, and so they're very, very happy to celebrate each other's, you know, holidays.
Well, we've been talking for over an hour now. Hopefully we don't have to edit too much out, although obviously a few bits of Simon's rather fruitier language we'll have to edit out or leave in, you know, maybe
beep out.
Yeah, we'll beep it out. Yeah. We ask each of our guests a series of the same questions at the end. And the first of those questions are, what have you been reading recently and what have you been watching recently?
Ah, okay. Reading. I'm reading Victor Klemperer's diaries. So he was a Jewish guy who became a Protestant when he married his wife in Germany. And it's from 1933 through to 45. He survived, you know, by hook or by crook. So it's very much a kind of, he doesn't concentrate on the big things. It's all about the day-to-day life of living as someone who's, you know, gradually being ground down by all these this sort of process. So it's really, really interesting. And it just reminds you about the kind of quotidian awfulness of living in a regime like that, where it's so petty-minded, it's so kind of the small things, the small indignities that grind you down, even before the Holocaust and that sort of stuff kicks off. So, and it's, you know, one of a series of books I'm reading. The one before that was Culture in Nazi Germany. It's a big, 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 thick book. And basically it's about how there was no culture in Nazi Germany and how they basically ruined the film industry, ruined the art, ruined sculpture, ruined literature, all this sort of stuff. So, you know, and you kind of read this and then you look at what's going on in our own country and the kind of cultural Philistines who are running the show. And so, yeah, those sorts of books I'm afraid I'm reading at the moment. But what have I seen recently? Well, I tell you, I one of the great delights of flying on Emirates is they have a channel devoted to classic cinema.
All right.
So on the way back, I watched two films which I'd seen long, long ago, and I'd forgotten how brilliant they were. One was Double Indemnity, which was based on a Stephen Kane novel. So it's a sort of that hard-boiled, you know, 1930s type of thing. Really, really, you know, crackling dialogue and smart story and things like that. And the other one was something I'd only seen part of, which was The Bicycle Thieves. This Italian movie, which I've heard, you know, everybody puts it, you know, when you speak, you know, hear a lot of directors talking about, oh yeah, one of my top 10 movies, and you're thinking, a story about, you know, set in Rome where somebody steals someone's bike, you know, and they try and get it back. You know, how exciting can that be? And then you watch this film and you think, yeah, no, I get it now. You know, it is absolutely astonishing. And I think it's that, you know, we tend to get sort of caught up in this, you know, constant cutting edge of modernity and so on, and you forget that there are, you know, there was a time when people actually wrote literate film scripts and you know, concentrated on, you know, just telling a very simple story as beautifully as possible. You know, now it's all kind of CGI, and it's that thing again about living out of a suitcase. You know, you realize that what the essentials are that make life worthwhile, you know, and rewarding. And I think it's seeing a film like The Bicycle Thieves just kind of puts that into that context. While sitting in a horribly uncomfortable chair being fed plastic food, you know, for 7.5 hours. But yeah.
Last one then. What have you been listening to, and do you listen to music when you write?
Well, I always have a soundtrack on when I'm writing, and it has to be a soundtrack. It can't be any lyrics because that's distracting.
Yeah, everybody's basically saying much the same thing when we ask them.
Yeah, so it tends to be Lord of the Rings because the Howard Shaw?
Howard Shaw, yeah.
Brilliant music. So it tends to be that, or it's Gladiator, or it's Master and Commander, which they're all cracking soundtracks.
I don't think Master and Commander is one that's on my list, but I definitely see the Gladiator and the other. So yeah, I will.
And then when I'm, you know, in down mode, I'm working my way through the Green Day catalogue at the moment, which is just amazing, you know, frankly. And sometimes, you know, if you can get a DVD of the videos as well, so when I'm doing Christmas wrapping or something, you know, I can sit there and watch endless Green Day videos. And some of them are really, really good.
So, great.
Yeah.
Excellent.
Well, that brings us to the end of our chat. So thank you ever so much for your time, Simon,
thank you.
Coming on.
Well, thank you, Stephen. Matthew, it's been a pleasure.
Oh, it's been brilliant.
Good luck with the books, guys.
Sorry, I missed that.
Good luck with the books.
Oh,
and you. Thank you. Thank you. I would say of all the authors, I think you and Bernard Cornwell are probably our two heroes, really. Mine, anyway.
Oh, bless your heart.
Yeah, definitely. Biggest inspiration.
So we've peaked early because we've had you both on in the first
year. Yeah, exactly. I don't know where we go next.
Yeah, well, yeah. But Bernard is—he's obviously a great interview subject. I mean, he's absolutely a cracker.
Yeah,
and he's a real good raconteur.
Yeah.
So, well, I think next is we'll have to get Lee Child and Stephen King on next year. See.
Yeah, that would be good. J.K. Rowling.
Yeah. Well, of course, Harry Sidebottom's always good value for money.
Yeah, we'll have him on eventually. Yeah. I'm sure.
There's lots of historical fiction authors that we've got lined up. So for anyone listening to this, there's lots more writers that, you know, will be coming on in the new year, I'm sure. And musicians and all sorts we've got lined up as well. So it'll be fun.
Wow. Okay. Well, I'll definitely tune in then, now I know about it. In the meantime, have a great Christmas.
You too.
And Happy New Year.
Thank you very much, Simon.
That's it for today's episode. We hope you've enjoyed it. Please let us know if you have any questions or things you'd like us to cover in future episodes. You can contact us on our Facebook page, which is facebook.com/rockpaperswordspodcast, or on Twitter. Our handle there is @rock_swords.
You can find out more about our books at matthewharfy.com and stephenamackay.com. We're also both on Twitter and Facebook and love to hear from readers and listeners, so drop by and say hi.
The theme music is written and performed and copyrighted by us. Until next time, a Rock, Paper, Swords, it's goodbye from me, Matthew Harfy.
And it's goodbye from me, Stephen A. Mackay.
And remember, whatever action and adventure you have going on in your life, be kind.
Stay safe.
And happy reading.
Okay.